unforeseeable losses. As we have discussed, expectation damages include not only loss in value, which is the difference between what the injured party would have received if the contract were performed, less the value of the defective performance, but also incidental and consequential damages, which are losses incurred in arranging a substitute transaction and injury to person or property resulting from defective performance. Now we will discuss how those other losses are limited by foreseeable damage and, as we heard before, the duty to mitigate damages. It is simple enough to say that damages are not recoverable for loss that the party in breach did not have reason to foresee as the probable result of breach when the contract was made. The general rule is that damages are not recoverable for loss that the party in breach did not have reason to foresee as probable result of breach when the contract was made. But how does this rule apply in specific cases? The seminal case on this point is the famous case of Hadley versus Baxendale. In Hadley, a flour mill had to stop milling flour when its crankshaft broke. The mill hired Hadley to deliver the broken crankshaft back to the crankshaft manufacturer for repair. Hadley promised to deliver the crankshaft to the manufacturer within one day. But due to Hadley's negligence, the delivery took 5 extra days. The mill sued for damages, which included lost profits for 5 days that it would have operated if it had had the crankshaft. Does Hadley, the shipper of the crankshaft, whose negligence caused the delay, have to pay for 5 days of lost profits at the mill? These are consequential damages that flowed from the breach. The question is, were they foreseeable at the time the contract was made? Whether or not Hadley has to pay turns first on whether the damages can be reasonably considered as arising naturally from the breach. And second, whether those damages might reasonably be supposed to have been in the contemplation of both parties at the time they made the contract as the probable result of the breach of it. The two rules, which are first, whether damages arose naturally from the breach, a causation concept, and second, whether the damages were reasonably foreseeable from the breach at the time the contract was made, a foreseeability concept, which you should be familiar with from torts, the concepts of causation and foreseeability as a limit to damages, are generally applied here where we have a sale of goods or services. In the case of Hadley, the court found that Hadley the shipper would have reasonably believed that a mill would have a spare crankshaft. And so damage to one crankshaft would not shut the mill down for the period of repair. Apparently at that time, mills generally kept spare crankshafts lying around, and since the mill did not tell Hadley that it had only one crankshaft and would be out of business until the time the delivery was made, and since Hadley had no other reason to know of these damages, the damages were not foreseeable. And so Hadley did not have to pay for the 5 days of lost profits at the mill because it would not have reasonably expected that a delay in delivery of the crankshaft would have caused the mill to shut down. It was more reasonable to believe the mill would have a spare crankshaft and be able to continue operating during that period. How do we make sense of such an old case to understand modern applications of the so-called foreseeability doctrine? According to Professor Melvin Eisenberg, there are 3 levels of foreseeability. The first level is in the ordinary sense, namely, any damages that could have been foreseen. Any damages in contract law seems to be too broad, as almost any damage that actually occurs probably could have been foreseen, unless it's truly a bolt out of the blue. The second level of foreseeability are damages that are not just possible, but reasonably possible. In other words, some damages are not just potentially foreseeable, but reasonably foreseeable, meaning that a reasonable person in a similar position to the breaching party would have foreseen them. And the third level of foreseeability are damages that are not just reasonably possible, but actually probable. And so we have this sort of range of unlikely but potential to about 50% possible to more likely than not. Which of these level of damages, which level of foreseeability are we going to apply when we limit expectation damages? It appears that the Hadley court required the injured party to show that damages rose to the third level of foreseeability, that a reasonable person would expect the damages to probably result from the breach, that it was more likely than not. And as Professor Eisenberg points out, this is actually a rather high standard, meaning the doctrine of foreseeability is a significant limit to parties' ability to collect expectation damages. The second restatement seems to adopt this restrictive position on the foreseeability doctrine as the Hadley Court presented. The restatement says, quote, loss may be foreseeable as a probable result of breach because it follows from the breach A in the ordinary course of events, or B as a result of special circumstances beyond the ordinary course of events that the party in breach had reason to know. Comments in the restatement explain that the requirement of foreseeability is a more severe limitation of liability than is the requirement of substantial or proximate cause in the case in action of tort or for breach of warranty. Indeed, the restatement's first illustration as to foreseeability and related limitation damages are essentially the facts of Hadley. The restatement seems to adopt the Hadley decision whole cloth. Therefore, we should understand that under common law, damages for incidental and consequential damages are strictly limited to damages that the breaching party should have realized at the time of contract formation were probable results from the breach. The third and highest level of foreseeability provides the strictest limitations on expectation damages. Next, we will discuss one more limit on damages, that a limit for speculative losses. But before we move on, are there any questions about the requirement of foreseeability in the calculation of consequential and incidental damages at expectation?
Right. Yeah, can you